Well, we're really excited about today. If you don't know me, I'm Randy Leidy. I'm Dean of the College. Every year, we organize the Grover Lecture. The Grover Lecture is an endowed lecture series. And every year, we bring in somebody to speak on some topic that we think is particularly relevant to the programs at our college. So every year, I spend some time thinking about who we might bring in, and I'm just really excited about today's lecture, because we've brought in somebody who I think has just fascinating things to say about the discipline of nursing, about healthcare in general, and who has really lived the life. And often we bring in speakers who are researchers and they talk about what they do in labs and everything, and I'm really excited that we have somebody who has actually lived what she's going to talk about. I don't know if you've had a chance to read the book, The Shift. I stumbled across Theresa Brown because I happened to see this book in a bookstore and bought it on a whim and read it and was just fascinated by it. And so we have Theresa Brown here today who, if you haven't read The Shift, it really, I think, is the best thing I've read that describes what it's like to work in a healthcare setting as a nurse, and it describes very well the relationship between a nurse and their patients, and a nurse and other professionals. And we thought bringing her in, the lecture will be at noon, and I hope many of you will stay for the lecture. But we thought it would be interesting to give you all as nursing students a chance just for an informal conversation with somebody who's lived the life. And so This session isn't about a presentation. It's just more a conversation, and you'll have a chance to just talk about whatever is interesting to you for the next hour or so. And so I'm going to turn the floor over to Theresa Brown.
Thank you. That was a very nice introduction, and I love hearing that someone just picked up my book in a bookstore and was captivated by it. So hi, I'm Theresa Brown. This is the book. It's coming out in paperback start of May, so whole new cover and everything with, interestingly, you realize the importance of this, they put a big clock, like an analog clock, on the cover. So this was the, shoes hidden, and then, because the clock really rules the day, as you know, if you've started doing clinicals. So I can talk a little bit. I actually love hearing from students because students tend to be very enthusiastic and really committed, and you haven't yet gotten into the job and sort of face the challenges of the job that can be taxing, especially when you're new. So if there's one thing I can say to you, it's hold on to that idealism. It is not misplaced. when you start your job, you may feel like, wow, I'm just struggling to keep my head above water, but you'll keep your head above water and eventually you'll learn to kick, and soon you'll be doing the backstroke, and if you hold on to your idealism, you'll always have it there to help you and serve you. So very quickly, I'm gonna talk more about this at my talk, but just so you know a little bit about me. My background is I have a PhD in English from the University of Chicago. My dad was a professor. I decided to follow in his footsteps, became a mom, realized I wanted a completely different job, and had a friend who's a nurse clue me into nursing. And then I found out about accelerated degree programs where people with bachelor's degrees or PhDs even could get the science classes they needed, go back to school, and quickly compared to the 4 years of traditional students, get a BSN. So I did University of Pittsburgh's program. I'm from Pittsburgh, I didn't say that, which is a crazy, crazy, crazy year, but I got what I needed and became a nurse. So here I am, and I've never regretted making that change, even though people are often mystified by it. But for me, it was definitely the right thing to do. So I've written two books. I also write for the New York Times on issues of nursing and healthcare. And I'm just going to throw out things I've written about because they may spark a question or an interest in you. So one of the most controversial columns I wrote was about physician bullying. They called it Physician Heal Thyself, H-E-E-L, you know, like a play, yeah, which I thought was very clever, but there were doctors who did not appreciate being compared to dogs. They didn't think it was funny. But the topic itself was very explosive at the time, but generated actually a lot of really, really great interest. And I'm actually now, there's a Wikipedia entry on bullying that says, oh, Theresa Brown really brought this into the arena of talking about this in relation to healthcare. So that was a really important contribution. And even in the time since I wrote that to now, I think things have gotten better. I mean, there's at least an awareness of we need to all try and be civil to each other. I've written about staffing. I've written about how we don't let patients sleep at night. And then lots of more human things. A cancer patient who her hair was falling out from chemo and she asked me to shave her head. Another patient who we arranged to have her dog come visit her in the hospital. Her dog was truly like this big. It was like a guinea pig. But she was so attached to this dog, and she'd been in the hospital for so long. And it was, you wouldn't believe the amount of organizing it took to get this dog into, you know, a separate room that had been clean beforehand and would be clean after. And she had to be in isolation gear, but she got to see her dog. And that was really, really wonderful. That probably gives you enough. Oh, another one I want to mention is, do you all know what HCAHPS are? The customer patient satisfaction surveys that are now mandated, and hospitals can get their Medicare reimbursements cut if they don't meet certain metrics on the patient surveys. And I actually find them very problematic and wrote a column about that. That, interestingly, I heard a lot of patients emailed me and said, oh, goodbye. and said, you know, patient satisfaction is so important, and told me these really horrific experiences they had had in hospitals and in the healthcare system, which was, it was great for me to get that feedback, even though it was painful. But, and I said to them, I completely agree with you, these experiences are horrible. I just don't think that this survey and the way it's being used is going to make these problems better. That we're sort of, the idea is, I think of satisfaction as something that you evaluate when you go on a vacation or you stay at Club Med, or but not in a hospital. It's just a very different kind of question. And I actually started the column describing a procedure that we do sometimes in oncology that's incredibly painful, where you actually insert something between the pleura of the lungs to irritate that space so that it will adhere. It's an attempt to try and stop fluid from forming in there. And apparently, from what people say and what I have seen, it's agonizing. And said, you know, to talk about satisfaction in this context is just not appropriate at all. So that's where I am. I guess I get my personal background. I have three kids. It was having twins that got me into nursing. They just turned 17. Two girls who love Ultimate Frisbee. And my son is 19, and he's a sophomore at Pitt. And I'm open for anything. Questions, comments. Oh, that's a great question. Yeah. Yes, I did, and that's what the book is about, my work on a bone marrow transplant unit. And then after working in hospitals and writing a book about a day in a hospital, I decided I wanted to see something else. So I went into home hospice a couple of years ago. So now I'm doing home hospice, and that's been amazing. When I was in school, and I'm not saying this about this program, but you know, no one ever talked about home care, and I definitely got educated with a bit of a prejudice against it. Like, that's people who can't cut it in the hospital. But it's really not that way. It's in its own way quite demanding. And I was, in fact, just talking to my supervisor about this, that she said she'll get nurses applying for jobs who say, well, you know, I'm older, I'm tired, I just want something easier. And she has to tell them, this job is not going to be easier, it's just going to be different, which is probably a good description. You know, less technical in a lot of ways. Obviously, there's no ICU in someone's home. For me, the hardest thing was getting used to the fact that I was alone. So if something really difficult or challenging was going on with a patient, I couldn't step out in the hall and talk to another nurse. I couldn't call in a code team. I couldn't have the pharmacist bring me anything. It was just me. And it was good for me to have that experience, but it did definitely take some getting used to, because it made me realize how used I was to just having a group of coworkers around me. Yeah, so several years of oncology, and now I'm in home hospice. Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. So the question was, you're learning about shared governance and interprofessional education, but then on the floors, you're seeing that reality is doesn't live up to the theory, right? Basically, that's the idea. And are there places that are better at it? Yeah, that's a great question. And I think that is tough because we try to inculcate people with this idea of collegiality and we're all in this together. And then in the hospital environment, there's a culture in place there that did not start with that idea. You know, it started with a much more stratified idea of there's doctors and there's nurses and there's respiratory therapists and there's aides, and there's a very clear sense of a hierarchy and where you fit into that. And what we found, which is really not surprising, but is that that kind of care model is not good for patients because it shuts down communication. And you really want a system where every person who's caring for that patient has the authority to speak to what would be best for that patient. And I love telling this story to illustrate that, that Rick Shannon, who was, I think it was just a physician at Allegheny Health Network, he's now at UVA running their system, but they had an issue in one of their ICUs with bronchoscopes that were giving patients infections, and he shut down the, it was patients getting central line infections, and they didn't know where they were coming from. Like, it was, you know, this record of central line infections that was really off scale. And so they were trying to figure that out. Does everyone know what a central line infection is? Okay. You have a permanent IV line and it gets infected. That's bad. And especially if they're cancer patients and we've knocked out their immune system, so then it's really bad. But so they couldn't figure it out. And we're having meetings and in the ICU and talking about it. And it was actually a housekeeper who said, you know what, Dr. Shannon, you know those bags, an AMBU bag, you know, that you pump if you need to give someone ventilations? I saw one of those bags, and it was lying with the mouth part on someone's IV dressing, which is just, I mean, just, like, it's not funny, but it's so absurd. It's, you know, you're taking what was in someone's mouth and putting it right on top of their IV line, right? And it's not a surprise people got sick. But then the housekeeper said, you know what you should do, Dr. Shannon? You should go to Home Depot and you should buy some hooks. And you should put some hooks up here. And then those bags could go on those hooks. And that's what they did. Simple, elegant, cheap solution, right? But if the environment had been this housekeeper, what does she have to say about healthcare? Nobody would have figured out what was going on. So I love that story, and I try to remind myself of it all the time, that everybody has something to say. Have I been places that are doing it well? I visited MD Anderson Cancer Hospital in Texas and Houston a few years ago, and I was really impressed with what they told me about their model, that they actually have a nursing council, but the members aren't chosen by managers, they're actually elected by all the nurses on the floor, so there's a sense of, we picked this person to represent us, and all the nurses on that council are required to be staff nurses. So you have to be working on the floor to go to the council, and any issue can be brought to your representative and they take it in, and their chief nursing officer, I really, really liked her, and she very graciously blurbed my book, Barbara Summers is her name. Very old school, but also very forward thinking, just a fabulous combination. And she said about these meetings, she said, you know, sometimes I don't know why they care about the things they care about, but they care about them. And she said, I've never said no, which I thought was really great, you know, to acknowledge that there can be concerns of clinical staff, that administration won't understand, and might find even, you know, a different way of solving them, right? But the clinical staff wanted X solution, and it was possible, and they made it happen. So that really, really impressed me. I think there are places also that have more civility initiatives, and please come in and sit down if you want. I know Montefiore in the Bronx has a tiered sort of response program where to address bullying and incivility, where, you know, if there's yelling at someone, that's the first level, and then you sort of go up the levels. And interestingly, they say they've never had to get to the top level, which I think is where they dismiss someone, that people either change or leave, which is really important because it says if you set a standard, people will meet it. So that's so much of what it comes down to, is having administration set a standard. And I don't know if you know this, but the Joint Commission a few years ago categorized, quote, disruptive behavior as a sentinel event and something that needs to be taken really seriously. And they talk about it as any kind of disruptive behavior by anyone toward anyone. So, if you haven't seen this, you may, but the classic, right, is physicians to nurses, but also nurses are not always kind and helpful to each other. Sometimes nurses are not nice to the new doctors. I know there are aides who feel like they really don't get treated well by anyone. And I think medical students often feel, it's not funny again, but it's just, it's so sad. They just feel like nobody takes them seriously. And a doctor friend of mine said, well, I think it's partly because they don't have a purpose, which I think is a great way of thinking about it. What is the purpose of a medical student? You know, as a nurse, I have no idea. They can't do anything for me. I can't go to them for help. So why are they there? And there's probably a reason why they're there, and I just don't know what it is. So some of that comes down to communication. And really, there are really basic things about nursing that new doctors don't know, and probably vice versa. But I just met with some of the pediatric fellows at the Pittsburgh Children's Hospital and was talking to them about how when doctors schedule medications for 7 a.m. or 7 p.m., how annoying that is to the nurses on the floor, because that's when change of shift is. And of course, the medication's not going to be given then, and I mean, let's just say it's very unlikely that it will be given at that time. And so there's this reaction among the nurses, like, don't the doctors know our schedule? Why are they doing this? You know, and all the fellows said, you know, no one tells us these things. No one tells us anything about how the nurses schedule their time. And so, it's such, you know, such a simple situation to remedy. Right, you know, a one-page paper, here's how their shifts run, here's how they handle things. Here's what they expect from you. Here's what you can expect from them. And if the, you know, if the residents and interns got that and we got that, just that level of communication would be huge, like really, really huge. So everyone doesn't have to keep reinventing the wheel and learning through trial and error when is a good time to schedule a med and when is not. So that was a very long answer, but the point is, obviously, I want this to happen, and I'm hopeful, and I guess I'll leave it at that. Yeah. Yes? Yeah, that's a great question. The phrase I come back to that I really, really believe in that gets sort of batted around a lot as a sort of business school thing is professionalism, and that I want all of you to think of yourselves as professionals. And being professional means you treat everyone you work with a certain level of respect and civility. Being professional means you really do put the patient first. You know, not to the point where, you know, you can't ever eat or you're so exhausted that you feel like you're going to pass out, but in general, you do put the patient first. And you try to model that behavior for the people you work with. And that can be very, very hard. Because in my first book, Critical Care, I talk about my first job, there was a lot of nurse-on-nurse bullying, and I ended up leaving that job and going literally across an elevator bay that was maybe a little bit wider than this platform, like from this floor to this floor. Medical oncology, a lot of the same patients, same doctors, just a completely different environment on the other floor. It was amazing. And again, that's a management problem, but what you can do is try to be the person you want other nurses to be. And the really hard thing about that is it's a very, very high stress job. Everybody has moments where they just feel like they've reached their limit. And when you get in a moment like that, it's very easy to yell at someone, make a snarky remark about someone behind their back, roll your eyes, blame someone else for the problems that are going on. And that blame may be completely appropriate, But if you can step back and think, is there another way? Like, could I go to my manager and say, here's what happened, I didn't like this, what could we do? Try to always keep in mind that the person you're slamming, you know, they've been in that same situation as you, and everyone's overstressed. But also, I think if you have coworkers who really are just incredibly toxic, you know, that really is something to take to your manager and just say, well, I'm seeing this. And it's hard when you're new because there's always a little bit of hazing that goes on, you know, giving the new person more challenges or you know, more patients. Like when I was a new nurse, for some reason, I was always the one getting 5 patients, and 4 was the usual load. So, I mean, I finally said, is there a reason why I'm always getting 5 patients? And did not get a good answer to that. And finally, I went to my manager and I said, you know, I'm always getting 5 patients. And she had no idea. And so she changed it. And this was the difficult floor, and probably they figured it out and then like didn't like me. But anyway, if you have a good working system, you should be able to approach a manager appropriately and say, here's what's going on, I don't quite get this. And if the environment is so toxic that that doesn't work or ends up coming back to bite you, then you might just need to get another job. That's what I tell students, and they always laugh, but it's, I mean, that's what I did. Like, okay, I'm either gonna quit nursing or I'm gonna get another job. And I got another job, and look, I'm still here. was exactly the right thing to do. And my hospital had a rule, you couldn't transfer jobs unless you'd been there for a year. And basically, I just like made them let me do that. So just by not taking no for an answer. You know, and you can't always do that, but you can try, right? And they'll see, this is a person with integrity we want to keep. They've already paid a lot of money to train you. They want you in their hospital, in their system, so they should work with you. Another long answer. Do you have any yes, no questions? I can, yeah. Yeah. That also a good question. I really liked peds, and I did my, yes. How did I find my way to oncology? How did I decide that was the job for me? So I really liked pediatrics. I did my actually transitions clinical at Children's in Pittsburgh, and I loved it, but it was too close to my own kids. I just found it too difficult. I've always said once they go to college, maybe I'll go back to pediatrics. But so then it was, what am I gonna do? And there's a lot of cancer in my mom's family. And it's, so I'd always been attracted by the field and also sort of scared of it. And the more I learned about it, I just felt drawn to that. And then actually, you know, the smallest things can make such a difference. The Oncology Nursing Society had come and left these bookmarks lying out around the student lounge in Pitt, and I just picked one of them up, and it said, 10 reasons why you should be an oncology nurse, and I read all of them, and I felt like, this is me! I mean, I truly felt that, and nothing about any other field had spoken to me that profoundly. So if you feel like you get a message like that, don't ignore it and think that it's stupid. You know, it may be your gut trying to tell you something, that you've found what you want to do. But the interesting thing is also, it took me a couple of years to fully figure out why I was in oncology. My mom had hairy cell leukemia. She's fine. She had it for about 10 years. It never went acute. It's a rare form of leukemia that usually people die with, not of. But it can become acute and then be quite deadly. Hers never did that, and a drug came out at just the right time. She did chemo at home, actually, in a dose pack, and she's been in remission ever since, like for over at least 15 or 20 years, yeah. And I think I just sort of put that part of my life away, and it was a couple years later, I was thinking about why I'm in oncology, and then bingo, it suddenly really, really made sense that I felt like I want to give back to this discipline that saved my mom's life. But I didn't get that right away. So again, if you feel an instinct or an impulse, I know, unless you have a history of your impulses leading you in really wrong directions, I would listen to it and let that be your guide. Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah, well, I will talk about this at the talk, too, so I'll try to give you a shorter version and so that you won't feel like, oh, I just heard this. It was really, well, being pregnant with twins is very difficult, and then having twins and a toddler is really difficult, but somehow in that mess of physical difficulty and exhaustion and laundry and puke and diapers, and I felt like a part of me came to life that I didn't know I had. I thought I was much more academic focused, and you know, I love books and I love reading and thinking and talking about ideas, but I also found out I have this part of me that wants to be with people and be useful in a very physical way that's also, you know, connected with really making a difference. I didn't know how to turn that into a job, and fortunately, I had a friend who's a nurse who gave me that idea, and I felt like, I can't be a nurse, I'm not a nurse. I'm just like not the right kind of person to be a nurse. I had a very, very stereotypical idea of who becomes a nurse, but I looked into it and found out about accelerated programs, and again, it just really spoke to me. It just seemed like the right thing. And I definitely also get the, why didn't you just become a doctor? Because I wanted to be a nurse, duh. people don't ask me that so much anymore, but I was going to become an advanced practice nurse. That was my goal, but I found out so much about bedside nursing and nursing school, and I thought, this is the coolest job. Just nobody talks about it. And I saw how important nurses are to how patients do and patient care. And yeah, I've been here ever since. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I'll give you the best piece of advice I got. And you might, if you want something more concrete, you can tell me. But I was on the job and struggling to get the hang of it. And a nurse who was also new, but not as new as I was, she'd been there for about 6 months or more, I think. You know, she said, one day, Teresa, you're just going to get it. And I thought, I'm not. Like, that day is just not going to come. And then one day, I got it, and I can't explain, but that feeling of, wow, I have all these phone numbers in my head, and there's all these different departments, and all these names, and all these drugs, and all these tubes, and it suddenly coalesced into, you know, something that made sense. And then about 6 months later, I had another, like, oh, now I really get it. So at the end of the first year, and that's what critical care takes you through, at the end of the first year, I did really feel like, okay, I'm a nurse. I've got this. So if you want to distill that down to a piece of advice, I would say don't give up on yourself. Have faith. The learning curve at the start of the job is like this. I mean, you'll get what you need from school, but then once you get on the job, it's very, very intense. You'll come home and just say, oh, this happened and that happened and I can't believe this. And, you know, I drew these tubes of blood and I sent them down to the lab and the lab lost them. And then the patient couldn't go for their procedure because the blood was lost. And I mean, just things happen. It's a very chaotic system because there are so many moving parts. And it's hard not to get down on yourself or feel like, why aren't I managing this better? And then one day you will manage it better. You just will. So hang on. Did you have a question? Yeah. Yeah, I think it's so hard, and from talking about this with other people, I really think we might need more nurses, but I think what we really need are more aides, or even maybe a sort of concierge for the floor, someone who can, you know, bring someone hot tea when they want it, or they really want a newspaper to read, or, these, as a nurse I work with, called them the little things. That if you have time in your day, it's so satisfying to be able to do that stuff. I mean, I have bought a patient a newspaper. I had a friend who I worked with who one patient really liked Fruity Pebbles. And it was kind of the only thing he would eat, and she would bring in boxes of Fruity Pebbles for him. Now, I'm not saying the point is you have to buy your patients things. You don't. It's having the time and the ability to be generous in a way that's not just strictly about healthcare. That can feel great. But when you don't have time, it's hard. And I think as a system, we're gonna have to find some way to adjust to that and acknowledge that you just can't keep stretching nurses. Something has got to give. One thing I'm seeing talked about more is just the issue of answering call lights. That there are hospitals now that have initiatives that any person who's there, physician, housekeeper, chief nursing officer, if there's a call light, they have to answer the call light. And just something like that seems so small, but huge, huge, huge to patients. Because, you know, you've probably seen this on the floors already, like, oh, there's 57 on the call light again because, you know, her ice cubes were the wrong size or whatever. And, you know, maybe it turns out that 57 actually needs to go to the bathroom and can't get out of bed, and she's in there panicking, and she ends up falling, and, you know, it's not that that's anyone's fault per se, because you have a patient who has been using the call light for all kinds of things that really didn't require immediate attention, but this time they do, and there's no way of knowing that. So just knowing, okay, if there's a call light, someone's going to be in that room in 30 seconds is great, because if it is really an emergency, then it can get, you'll know it's going to get taken care of right away. I've also heard of systems where the call lights are more precise, so the patient can click that they need pain medicine, they can click that they need food, maybe click for the bathroom. I'm not sure how they work, because I've never used a system like that, but I think like a smart system like that really makes a lot of sense. And, you know, as much as you can, be honest with your patients. I mean, I don't think it's great to go in and say, you know, I have four other patients, because nobody wants to hear that. But if you feel there's someone who either appropriately or inappropriately is going to be asking for a lot from you, is there a way to let them know that, you know, when you leave, say, okay, I'm going to be back at this time. Can you ask the aide to share checking in with you? Can you tell them, you know, let's have our goal for today be that we stay on top of your pain and really make sure that I treat your pain? So can they be compelled to focus on something that's a little more manageable than, I'm in the hospital, I'm out of control, I'm miserable, I need everything at once. Nobody can satisfy someone like that. You know, they're just in a really difficult place. So I don't know if that's helpful. I think basically we're going to need people. If we're going to focus so much on satisfaction, there's going to have to be more people on the floors who can meet these basic needs of activities of daily living, right? And then nurses can give medication when they need to, and physicians can do what they need to do, and it just works out better. Another question? Thought? Comment? Yep. I'm sorry, one more time. Okay, she said, what's the most fulfilling part of nursing? Oh, this I can give a short answer to. My patients. I love my patients. I love my patients. Even the annoying, difficult patients, I love them too. So it just knowing I make a difference every day it's so rewarding. And it's even more intense in home care because I'm in their house as a guest trying to help them. So it's great, yeah. Do you want more of an answer than that? Okay. Was there another hand over here? No? Oh, you've got a question. I'm sorry.
Just talk about it. Can you talk a little bit more about home health care, the challenges, the rewards, different skills that are required, and how it compares to being in a hospital setting?
Yeah, definitely. Like I said, the hardest part for me was realizing I was alone. The weirdest part is getting paid for driving around. That took me a while. I'm like, but all I'm doing is driving, and I get paid for this time. And after, you know, being in the hospital where you never had time, you're constantly running, that just seemed very odd to me. But then I realized, oh no, this is what makes home care possible, is me going to people's homes rather than them having to come into a center. And then I thought, in the old days, I would be, you know, a midwife on a horse, and which I could go for a horse, but but it would take me a really long time to get to all my patients' homes then. So you can't look at that sort of downtime, which it isn't really, as I'm not really working, because you're doing what makes it possible to do that work. Your assessment skills are actually really, really important. You know, that head-to-toe assessment that you learn, because you're there, you're the only person usually seeing these patients in a clinical way. I mean, a physician might go to the house, but the nurse is really the prime provider of care and home care. And so listening to lungs, seeing how people are doing, are they really having bowel sounds? Gee, your last bowel movement was a week ago and your stomach hurts? These things become very important because you've got someone in their home who wants to stay in their home. We don't want them to have to go to the hospital or an urgent care center to get care. So you've really got to be paying attention amidst, the dog is barking. I mean, we ask people to put dogs away, but not everyone does, which is fine. You know, the dog's barking, the TV's on in another room. They're trying to talk to you about, chicken salad that they made the day before. I mean, it's a much less controlled environment than in a hospital. And I like that, but it requires you to be kind of split, the sort of clinical side of you and then the social side of you. And I said, I'm there as a guest because I saw, you guys hadn't, did you see the American Nurse movie? I saw a poster for it up on the wall. But not yet, okay. Well, I was at the premiere of that movie and one of the nurses is in home care, this really great guy from Kentucky. So I met him right before I was starting home care and I said, what's your one piece of advice for me? And he said, never forget that you're a guest in their home, which was great, really, really, really great. Such an important thing to keep in mind. Other challenges, you've got a box of equipment in your car. That's all you've got. you can try and get someone to bring you something if you need it, but if you get to a house and try to put in a Foley and it doesn't work and you don't have another one, I mean, that can be incredibly stressful. I have never been in that situation, thank goodness, but I worry about it, obviously, right? I have gone out to draw blood from people, which I'm okay at, I'm not great at it, and I was about to make a whole bunch of excuses, right? Their veins were shot, blah, blah. Anyway, I've loved it, and felt very stressed out about that. Like, oh, now someone else is gonna have to come to this house to do the job that I couldn't do. So that's hard to feel like I should be here and be able to do everything and I'm not able to. And also just the challenge of so much of the work is over the phone. You know, you're talking to your supervisor over the phone or email or texting. There's not that same camaraderie of the nurse's station and getting together, and that sometimes I really miss. I miss that getting together with other nurses. But I'm fundamentally, I think, a pretty independent person, and so that's, I can cope with that. It's okay. And I use the driving time as my processing time. I listen to music and just try to, put that visit behind me so that I'm not dwelling on it when I get to the next visit and then the next visit and the next visit. But I quite like it. It's also, it's a ton of paperwork. And like if you think you have paperwork in the hospital, which you do, you have a crazy amount of paperwork and you'd think home care would be better, but it's not, and hospice is becoming more and more and more regulated. And it's just ridiculous. The company I work for now is very committed to having us spend as little time as possible documenting. And so they designed their own software, which actually makes sense when you do it. I mean, there's still, stuff that feels silly, but it's necessary for regulatory reasons, and they've really streamlined it as much as they can. And we just got an announcement that they're working even more on that to make it even better. So that is huge for them to say, we want you to be with patients, not just on your laptop. So finding a good employer who really gets the challenges, that's great too. And I think most people do, but then do they have the ability and the wherewithal to do something to make those challenges easier for you to deal with? That's important. So I'm a per diem. That's the only way I can work and also do stuff like come here. So I usually work 2 days a week, sometimes three. And it depends. I'd say 3 to 5 patients. I'm doing eights now, so. And sometimes I'm set to see more patients and someone's not home, or they say, you know what, I'm really tired, don't come. Or one day I actually couldn't get up the hill to someone's house because it was snowing and icy. So it's 3 to 5, yeah. And sometimes the suburbs of Pittsburgh are, you know, they spread, right? So sometimes I do end up doing a fair amount of driving, and then that cuts into the number of people I can see. Yeah. Yeah, that's a great question, and right, well, even as a guest, yes, you don't want to let someone continue to do something that's dangerous or, like, you know, incredibly unhygienic. Or the classic example is, and we've had this come up, people who smoke while they're on oxygen. And the thing is, you can lecture them about your house could blow up, or you could set your face on fire, and that's maybe gonna work, but probably they're just gonna tune you out because they've been scolded about that so many times before. My supervisor said, you know, you can always tell people, fine, you know, it's okay, I get it, but just turn off the oxygen when you're smoking. So to try to come up with a solution that is commonsensical and accommodates the fact that it is their house and they're living there. And the thing is, you know, I go there and then I leave. And so whatever I tell them, I may be amazingly persuasive, but they may just ignore what I say as soon as I walk out the door. So I really have to think about what's the most important thing to get across here and focus on that. So, I go in a home and the patient isn't really giving enough pain medicine because there's a concern about narcotics. The family's just not comfortable with it. So then I would focus on talking about that. Or a patient with delirium and the family doesn't know what to do, and it's escalating. Okay, well, let's try a more regular, let's try a scheduled dose of Haldol to try and take care of that and really focus on what's the thing here that really needs to happen. Luckily for me, I've never been in a home that was just horribly, horribly dirty or unsanitary. We did have a nurse who was going into a home with a terrible flea infestation, and she said, it's my last visit of the day, I go home and then I take my clothes off in my garage. And actually our physician said, you know what, we just need to discharge this patient because that isn't fair to you. Because we had suggested having someone come in to take care of the fleas using a flea bomb. You know, the patient didn't want any measures taken to get rid of the fleas at all because the nurse had really tried. And we ended up discharging the patient because the physician said, I can't ask you to do that. I mean, apparently it was an incredible flea infestation, like really, really incredible. So it, you know, pick your battles. Yeah.
So a big focus now is on being very attentive to our patients. And I came up with making them feel hurt. You balance that with professional distance that you have to exercise in that kind of situation.
Right. Yeah, I mean, you do want to hear people. On the other hand, and this is hard, but on the other hand, if someone has a misconception or they don't understand something, then it really is our job to educate them, but it's doing it in a way that's respectful to that patient and family member. So I'm going back to pain medicine a lot because I'm in hospice, so that's what we deal with a lot. A lot of times people, they don't understand the difference between OxyContin, the long-acting, and oxycodone, the short-acting for breakthrough pain. And just sitting down and talking with them about that can make a really big difference. And there's a lot of concern about addiction. You know, it's so hard to be a hospice nurse and see someone in pain who's dying, and the family says, we don't want to give them the morphine because we don't want them to become addicted. And, you know, and what you want to say is, wow, that's just so irrelevant. But that is not going to help, because they're worried about that. So then you have to go through and talk about, you know, that's not going to happen in this instance. The patient really needs the pain medicine. You know, I understand your concerns. So you know, you can validate where people are coming from, but at the same time educate them. And I've never had anyone doing something crazy like, you know, I put paint thinner in my husband's tea because that's how he likes it. Or, you know, I mean, something just totally crazy where you would feel like, wow, this is criminal and dangerous. So people, in my experience, people really want to do well. I mean, I've seen people, I've met them, caregivers of hospice patients who I met them and I think, wow, I can't believe this person had a job. They just seem so scattered and unfocused. But they are very focused on the patient. They really want to do a good job for the patient. And that's what I try to tap into. You know, here's what you can do. Here's the best thing that you can do. And if they're focused on something that doesn't do any good but doesn't do any harm and isn't making them crazy, you know, whatever it might be, taking a vitamin every day or breathing in eucalyptus, I don't know what. Actually, I like breathing in eucalyptus if I have a cold, but you know, you gotta give people their space sometimes. If they feel like having the dog in the bed makes the morphine work better, you know? Is there any harm in having a dog in a bed, you know, as long as it doesn't hurt the patient? I'm not thinking up good examples because I've never run into this. I really see people with good intentions who sometimes just don't understand what we're trying to do. I mean, there are a few bad apples, but I think most people, if they've committed to having a loved one in their home for hospice, you know, at some level, they know what they're getting into. Doesn't mean it's not hard, it's very, very hard. But they do have that basic level of commitment. Yeah.
You work with Robert and Johnson Foundation. Mm-hmm. Could you talk a little bit about that and then what it's like to be a participant in a foundation that
we're
in the nursing organization
to help students? Yeah, sure. Yeah, and I should just say briefly, too, a sort of plug for the profession, which is you have so many options in nursing. You could do clinical work, which I obviously love, you know, hospital care, home care, but you can also work in foundations, you can teach, you can work in clinics, you can do research, you can work for insurance companies, which some people think is evil, but actually there's really good work that can be done with insurance companies by nurses. So, you know, again, remember that you have options always. And I've even had physicians tell me sort of enviously, like, oh, you're so lucky because you can change what you do. And you know, I guess 20 years of a specialty, maybe you want to change after a while as a doctor. But yeah, so the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation is a big money foundation in Princeton, New Jersey, that supports a variety of healthcare initiatives, and they have this big nurse leadership program. And I've been part of two of their initiatives, and I'm actually going there in May when the paperback comes out to talk about the book and talk about nursing. The great thing about doing work like that is you really get a sense of the big picture. What are the problems in our system? How could we maybe fix them? And that can be incredibly empowering to find out that people all over the country are struggling with the same issue. So one of the panels or the initiatives I was on was about called Flip the Clinic. So do you know the Khan Academy, the flipped classroom? So this was the idea of what would it look like if we flipped the clinic? And I think basically we realized that it was a really, really huge issue that needed to be focused in some way. But there were a lot of very strong opinions about what that would look like. So that was great. The frustrating thing in working with a foundation like that, and I think a lot of foundations, is their thinking is up here, and they don't have a lot of boots on the ground connection, and so they aren't always aware of how complex the day-to-day difficulties can be of the job, and also aren't as aware of why implementation might be really, really tough. You know, so sort of like you'll see this on the floor as an initiative comes down. Now we're doing X. We're all doing X. Let's do X, 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 X. And then for some reason, you know, because X wasn't really thought through, and it just stops. You know, and then a couple months later, now we're doing Y. And the same thing happens, and it breeds a kind of cynicism. That like, oh, we get all these initiatives, but they're not really working. So I would say, yeah, that's definitely the challenge. With any, it's not just Robert Wood Johnson, but any healthcare foundation. Because I'm on the board of the Pittsburgh Jewish Healthcare Foundation. And they have done really amazing work in Pittsburgh over many, many, many years. And the thing that really impresses me about them is they do such a lot of work to connect with frontline caregivers. And they're quite open about the ways they feel like they sometimes fail to really grasp that. I mean, even small things like they had a workshop and they had someone come in who was a black belt to talk about, I don't know, discipline and efficiency or something. And the director of the foundation said, people hated it. The healthcare people, like they felt like, I don't want to hear from someone who knows karate when I'm in healthcare. You know, I know my problems. That person does not know what's going on with my job, and I'm just really not interested in that at all. But I thought for her to be able to recognize that and say that was great. You know, instead of saying we brought this program in and they didn't like it. I don't know why. You know, so it's being in a big picture job can be fantastic. You just want to make sure that you don't lose sight of what's actually going on day to day for clinicians and for patients, both.